Good evening.
Okay, fine.
Are you Count Chocula? So what was that?
You want me to start over?
Go.
Hey, everyone.
What?
I don't know. It's been a long day.
Okay.
I'm Jeff.
I'm Jennifer.
So we just wanted to talk about, real quick, the panel that we saw that was for Fear the Walking Dead at last weekend's WonderCon. That might have been, I don't know if I would say, no, I wouldn't call it the highlight. But in terms of the stuff that we follow here in our little world, probably.
Sure.
Because there wasn't a whole lot else, like we said before.
Unfortunately, the stars, a couple of the stars, the big stars weren't there.
No, well, most of the big stars were there.
Sure. I don't know about most.
Half of the big stars.
Okay, tell me. Who was there?
Well, let's run down then. Okay, so Kim Dickens, Madison Clark, she was supposed to be there, but she couldn't make it. From the look of it, from what they said, they're still filming. They showed a little.
Oh, right. She pulled, yes.
They showed a little piece.
They showed her, it was kind of. corny. It was cornball.
Well, it wasn't in character. She just pulled up in a pickup
I know.
Truck
she and, pulled up like they're in the desert and she pulls up in a big old Dodge truck or something. And she's like, hey, everybody, I can't be here right now because I'm still on set shooting in wherever they're at. Where are they? Do you know?
I think New Mexico. Yeah, one of those. Maybe Texas.
Yeah, so.
So she's not there. I was hoping that, like, when the truck drove off, like, some zombies were going to, like, moan after her.
I kept waiting for zombies. Why didn't they do that?
So that's why I wouldn't have called it corny, because they didn't do that. But I wish they would have done that.
No, that would have been less corny if they did the zombies. She was, like, acting like something was following her. She's like, hey, I got to go. As if zombies were coming. Oh, but then they didn't show any zombies.
No, I think she was just, you know, they just needed her on set.
They could have easily used footage from anything that they've shot just to throw it in there. That's what you and I would have done.
That's true. We would have done that because you're paying service to the fans at a thing like this. But in any case, she wasn't there. Who was there? We had Alycia Debnam-Carey, also known as Alycia Clark in the show. She was there. And then Colman Domingo, AKA Victor Strand. He was there. And then what was kind of, maybe a little strange, I thought, because her character was sort of shrouded in mystery, was Danay Garcia, who plays Luciana, with Nick's paramour of sorts. But she just wandered off in the last season, and she was all sad, and she and Nick had been fighting, and he wanted to stay, and she wanted to go.
She must be coming.
Well, so she's definitely coming back. Mm-hmm. I didn't figure she was going to be dead, because she was kind of an important character. She couldn't just die off screen.
Of course.
But there was a mystery there, so I was surprised that they would reveal her before the start of the season, that's all.
Right, I agree.
If anything, I figured she would have just shown up and surprised us all, and then we could be like, yay, Lucy's here! But now it's going to be like, well, Lucy's here.
Maybe they called her in when they didn't have Madison or Nick.
Well, but she's definitely back in the show.
I know, I'm just saying.
And then there were the new characters that were coming in, and the highlight of that. And I think as you hear this panel, I think you'll agree he was probably the highlight of the panel too. Lennie James. So Morgan, who in the show is American, and it's so awesome, I guess. I enjoy it anyway, hearing these actors with their completely different accents.
No, I was thinking the whole time we were watching these British actors.
Well, Alicia's,
it's hard for them to have an American accent.
Alicia's Australian.
Right.
Close,
that's right.
But not quite the same. But yeah, it must be very trying to have to do all of your lines in that made up voice. But maybe it could be fun. It's probably exhausting, but also a lot of fun. And then you get to go out and blow everyone's minds. I'm pretty sure, remember that show House?
Yeah.
I can't remember the guy's name now, but what's his face? The guy that played House
was British.
Yeah. And he's like a really famous, I should be able to remember his name.
Oh, now he's more sexy than he was before. He wasn't that sexy before. It gives him a little bit of more sexy.
He's a really famous British comedy actor. But then, so then people would be like, oh my God, you're Dr. House and you're the guy that always talks really down here like this and you're talking about your drugs. But then in real life, he's like, pip, pip, hello.
No.
Hello, governor. I'm gonna, you know, he's like that guy.
I'm going to have to look him up so I can hear him talk.
Yes, you should do that. But we're not going to do that now. So Lennie James was there with all his British accent glory. And he is so what we found, and again, you'll hear this in a second, but we also tweeted about it. I'm excited is that it's not just that Morgan is crossing from show to show, but they're going to do something on what's the date? April 15th?
22nd.
April 22nd, I mean. Are you sure?
No.
They're going to bridge the two shows.
Right. Officially. Now I'm confused because I thought
right, Fear, it is April 15th.
Fear, it's April 15th?
Mm-hmm.
I must have been looking at something else.
Or wait, did I say April 15th? I don't know. One of us was right. The point is, you were saying.
I thought Fear the Walking Dead took place before The Walking Dead.
That's why someone in the audience was asking about time. Because it doesn't make any sense to have Morgan cross over right now in real time.
Yeah.
Something, so we know Fear the Walking Dead left off with this big explosion, and we don't know what's happening between then and now, but there must have been a significant passage of time. Because Morgan in Walking Dead...
Well, that's good.
People have figured out the Walking Dead timeline, and I could look it up, but I'm pretty sure we're about 2 years post-apocalypse.
Right.
And Fear the Walking Dead does not feel like it's even close to that. I feel like it hasn't been a year. So maybe this is like
3 years later that they're going to come in.
Well, maybe a year has passed.
Right.
Well, if Morgan has to cross over from... So the season finale of Walking Dead and the season premiere of Fear the Walking Dead are going to be like back to back on AMC. So if Morgan's going to leave that show and that show is about 2 years post-apocalypse, then I would say maybe Fear the Walking Dead is going to fast forward about a year. But gosh, that's a long time. Seems like a bit of a shame. But we do get
more. No, it would have to fast forward like 2.5 years or whatever, 2 years and a month. Because if
if the apocalypse happened, I mean,
years ago, the apocalypse happened, right?
Let's say it's about that, yes.
Okay. Fear the Walking Dead is before that, so it has to be 2 months and a month or 2 years and a month.
No, Fear the Walking Dead starts at the day one of the apocalypse. At the start,
right. And it's been 2 years since Walking Dead has been happening.
Right. But we're not still on day one of the apocalypse, babe. They were in the boat. They went down to Mexico. They went into Texas or wherever the fuck.
Okay.
That's what I'm saying. So,
but I feel like that's only been like 30 days. I don't know.
Well, a lot of that's because we binged it. But we could give it a year. I don't know if anyone's come up with a Fear the Walking Dead timeline.
Well, I'll buy that. And that's interesting. Then are they going to start Walking Dead off also in the future?
Why? No. Wait, what? No. Because if Fear the Walking Dead starts now, you're confusing me now. If Walking Dead starts at its point of now, where we're watching it, then Fear the Walking Dead needs to fast forward. If you have Walking Dead also fast forward, then Fear the Walking Dead has to fast forward two times, babe.
Okay.
It's been a long day. But at least that one, I think I've got figured out. Are you trying to confuse me? Is that what this is?
No,
all right. So Morgan was there. You're going to hear him talking. And then the other actors joining the show are of some note. There's Garret Dillahunt, who, according to IMDb, is playing a character called John.
John.
Very clever name. I don't know much about Garret Dillahunt. I looked him up. He's been on a lot of TV shows, some movies, but strangely, nothing that we really have ever watched. There's Maggie Grace, who we know from Lost. She was the spoiled chick on Lost, Shannon.
Oh.
The one that, in the first episode is sunbathing. Yeah. Yeah. While everyone else is working. And then she was also in the Taken movies. Did we see Taken together? I'm pretty sure I saw that in the theaters, but it was so long ago. I don't know if that was. All right. And I think she was in all three of the Taken movies, which are now over. But she's joining as a character called Althea. Did we get a sense? There was a preview that they showed. I don't know if I got any kind of sense of Althea. But then there was also Jenna Elfman.
Oh, yes.
Jenna famously Elfman. Known as Dharma.
I'm excited for Jenna. She seems fun.
Yeah, she does seem fun. Her character in the show looked like possibly kind of a badass. She looked like she was going to be pretty tough.
You don't think there's going to be any comic relief from her, huh?
I don't know. There's not a lot of room for comic relief in this show general. But it would be nice to have some once in a while.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we do get it every once in a while. I mean, kind of.
Has Fear the Walking Dead had much comic relief? Walking Dead has some once in a while. That's what I was talking
about, Fear the Walking Dead. Like, well, no, I know. But Madison and...
Strand?
Strand.
Right. Did I say he was there? Colman Domingo was there. Yes. Victor Strand. Okay. Yeah, Madison name. And Strand, they had Colman Domingo. That's
he talks name. in person or on the panel exactly as he speaks.
Well, right. And so does Kim Dickens. She's Madison. That's her voice.
I know, but he's like very, you know, eloquent.
Yes. He's a good talker, as opposed to Kim. I mean, she's not very a bad talker, but he has a great voice. And then Alycia and Lennie were just completely balls out different.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Although Alicia's accent's not very thick.
Not like Lennie.
No. Yeah, right. It was really fun hearing him.
So we should probably get on with it then. Oh, and of course, the panel was hosted by Chris Hardwick.
Of course.
He's all kinds of awesome, and he's the Walking Dead guy with all of his after shows. So it's just a lot of fun. It was a really fun panel. I'm glad we were there. We recorded all the audio. Hopefully it turned out okay. I'll let you guys be the judge of that. If you have any questions, comments, feedback, angry words, love notes, hit us up. We're on Twitter, @KidFreeWeekend, Facebook, The Kid Free Weekend. You can reach us at thekidfreeweekend@gmail.com. And we always love to hear from anyone that's listening. So say hi.
Yes, please.
And if you're just here because you found out the Walking Dead panel from WonderCon was going to be on this thing that we do, click the subscribe button on your podcast app. Come back because we'll be talking about plenty more Walking Dead in the great void in our lives between seasons of Game of Thrones.
I'm sure we will.
Yep. All right. Here's the panel.
This time it is my pleasure to bring out the moderator of this panel for AMC's Fear the Walking Dead, Mr. Chris Hardwick.
Hello. My name tag is true, it is me. Sorry. Welcome to WonderCon 2018. What year is this? I think it's 2018. Thank you so much for coming out. This is incredibly exciting. This is the Fear the Walking Dead panel. You're going to see stuff no one's ever seen before. Things are going to be revealed. Your minds will expand. Did you guys, I'm sure you're aware of the announcement that Kirkman made at New York Comic Con last year that a character was going to cross over and it was announced that it was Morgan, and we announced it on Talking Dead. And now we are literally just a few weeks away from seeing how it's all going to play out together. The season finale of Walking Dead this year will dovetail into the premiere of Fear the Walking Dead, and then my stupid face will be on right after that, being like, hey, everything's okay, you guys. Thank you. So Morgan is not the only new face. There are several new cast members here today. And this is the first time that we have all of them here together with EP's new showrunners. Season 4 premieres April 15th. It's being called Survival Sunday, because why wouldn't it be? And then we're going to have cast from both shows on Talking Dead that night. Fear Season 4 will have, thank you, 4 people were excited about that. sometimes it takes a minute to get the rolling applause, and then if it doesn't catch, I know. You know what it is? No one wants to put themselves out there in a group. You know, if you're like, yeah, no one else, you're like, nah, forget it, not me. You know, like, you don't want to be the one to start it. So don't be afraid. Let the wave carry you. It's Saturday at WonderCon, damn it. So, Walking Dead, even if you're patronizing me, I'll take it. Catch up on seasons 1 through 3 of Fear, which is streaming now on Hulu. And without further ado, because I want to make sure we have plenty of time to open it up for audience questions and whatnot, I'm going to show you the never-before-seen trailer for season 4 of Fear the Walking Dead. Here it is! Roll it, thanks.
Thanks, I love these places. You ever been?
Been a while. They made really good churros.
Yeah, they did.
So she's actually working, but she did send in a little video. So let's run the Kim tape real fast, and then we'll get into the panel.
Hey, WonderCon, it's me, Kim Dickens, reporting live last night from a set of Fear the Walking Dead here in Austin, Texas. I'm sorry I can't be there. Thank you all for coming out. I know the rest of the cast is excited. I know they're all cleaned up and beautiful, and I'm still here holding down the dirt and holding down, taking care of the zombies and stuff. But thanks for coming out. We're really excited for you to see season 4. It's going to be a great one. All right, I gotta go.
It was so convenient. There was just that drive-through camera right there that you could just drive up to and start talking at. That was really good. So, Scott, let's just very much get into this. It's season 4. You are now sort of the content overseer of this universe. And so what is different about Fear the Walking Dead this year? And what do you think the new team is bringing to the table?
It's everything that you've loved about the show. With these new ingredients, with these new people, they're in a very new situation, and the characters themselves have a great deal of new relationships going on between them. Things have evolved between the characters. Enemies have become friends. People who maybe weren't in charge, and they find themselves in very different situations. And I'll look at these two men, have I given anything away?
Just enough.
Okay, very good.
Well, Andrew, what sort of themes are you guys exploring this year? And what's the jump from, because at the end of last season, everything ended in a way where you're like, maybe they'll all die, maybe they'll all live, what's happening? So what was the jump between last season and this season?
Really kind of the big thematic thing we're dealing with is, end of last season, everyone, we don't know where they are, but also on a personal level, relationships were fractured, people weren't in the best place. So really this season is all about a journey from isolation to community, and it's about people in a very bleak and dark world trying to find just that little shred of hope that gives them the thing to keep on fighting.
Right, and so Ian, for you, what was sort of tantalizing about being able to pull in Morgan to this world and really connecting the two shows?
We have all been fans of Morgan from Walking Dead and of Mr. James. We started this season with an idea of an emotional story that we wanted to tell that honors everything that's happened in the first three seasons with these characters, but also takes them to new emotional places. And Morgan's journey on The Walking Dead, kind of when we started to talk about the journey of these characters, it just lined up in a way that it became undeniable that he should be part of the fabric of the story.
And
I'm very excited.
And so coming into the show, what was your plan, and do you feel like it's evolved, or do you feel like, yeah, we totally got this, or are you still learning and figuring it out? Like, where do you feel like you're at now as showrunners with this, with your Walking Dead season 4?
We're very tired. But I think we kind of set out to achieve what we set out to do, and I mean, just this week we kind of pitched the end of the season to AMC, and definitely in a different place than maybe we imagined 8 or 9 months ago when we first started talking about it, but we're kind of very excited about where we hopefully are going to end up.
Great. So for Nicotero, because the thing that I always ask you about each season of, the other Walking Dead show, that other one, is that each season you kind of have to up the ante on the walkers, and they're decaying more, and you try new gags and you try new stunts. But then as the infected on Fear the Walking Dead, it was sort of a different aesthetic quality.
Right.
And so how are you balancing the two shows, tying them together but keeping this one, like what gags are you excited about for this show that are unique to Fear?
Well, these guys came up with some great stuff. We dip into our zombie pool as often as we can.
In this case, literally.
Literally, yes. There was a zombie pool, seriously. What's exciting for me, I still can't get over the fact that we've been doing this 8-9 years and we're still surprising ourselves, we're still coming up with stuff that hadn't thought of or just hadn't got to yet.
I think that the writers, these guys have crafted some really great moments. And, you know, there is some continuity between the two shows now that, you know, they live in the same universe, but they each have their own fingerprint, their own blueprint. The Walkers will probably be the one thing that will be the most consistent because of the way they decay, the way that they look. So we really wanted there to be a consistency between the two shows in terms of how they look. What these guys have done in their team of writers is they've come up with some amazing, amazing opportunities, and it's gotten me really excited. You know, I directed the finale for Walking Dead. I worked with Lenny and realized that when I was hugging him and saying goodbye that I was going to see him in a couple weeks on Fear the Walking Dead. So fortunately for me, I don't have to say goodbye to him. Just finishing Walking Dead and being involved with Fear, it's been great having the new actors coming in and sort of teaching them ways to kill zombies and seeing how good they are at it. Jenna kind of got it like that. So it's been really exciting. And you know, in the past, you know, with Fear the Walking Dead, because they were infected, they were less decayed. The look of them was a little different. So now we're getting a chance to really throw that all out the window and really jump in with some amazing makeups and some great characters and performances.
Yes, right. Because I remember when Fear started, people had like 5 seasons of Walking Dead, you know, and so when the apocalypse started happening in Fear, viewers would be like, just stab him in the brain! You're like, these people don't know that!
Right.
Like, that guy could just be on drugs, you can't just start stabbing people in the eye, you know? So it seems like the show is kind of caught up in terms of the understanding of what the apocalypse is at this point on Fear.
Yeah, and the understanding of what you have to do to survive.
Right.
You know, and one of the things about this show that I really like, listen, the scripts have been so great, these guys can attest to that. Every time I would read a script, I get the last page, I can't wait to find out what's gonna happen next, the way that they've laid out the story. So for me, just as a guy who's reading the scripts and knowing what these stories are coming to, but in that regard, yeah, you know, you have to learn how to work together to survive in this world. And then, of course, the pitfalls of who are the good guys, who are the bad guys, how they interact. And in this season of Fear, you know, we get a chance to see these characters. And as our timeline is played with a little bit here and there, you're not going to just see the same person from episode to episode, but time is going to affect who they become and who they are and how they react.
Excellent. Colman Domingo. First of all, I adore Strand is such a great character. You know, when we first see him, he's very cool, he's very collected, he knows what's going on, he seems like a guy to follow, and then he just starts crumbling, and you really start to see the humanity of him, and then you find out, oh, he's not at all what he is trying to put out into the world. Is he a good guy, is he a bad guy? I don't know. He definitely is on Victor Strand's side. So how has he evolved for you these last 3 seasons, and what are you excited about seeing him grow in season 4?
I've always said that Victor Strand has been sort of a symbol of deconstructing capitalism, all the things that we hold near and dear, and we've seen that, you know, from him showing up in his shiny Ralph Lauren suits, and, you know, he was the man who had the plan, and then his plan started crumbling, and then he found out the inner workings of this guy, and why he does what he does. Which is always very complicated, and sometimes complicated to himself. And at the end of last season, I thought that it was very symbolic that he was trying, he was grabbing at straws. By the time Alycia showed up, and she's a nurse to the proctors, he didn't know what was going on. So this season has offered him a new possibility to be a part of something, whether it's building community, it's not being on just about Victor Strand, for the first time, to be a part of something bigger. And that's what I think the message is about, how we rebuild civilization. And we have to, you know, use our talents, even the talents that may be seemingly nefarious at times, but to use it for the group survival. So he's trying and testing that out, and we'll see how that goes.
Are we gonna see a lot of smooth Victor Strand, or are we gonna see a lot of...
Lifting his skirt, running for the hills?
Sure.
No, we'll see a lot of...
You totally have to put that in a script.
I think we'll see a complicated version of Victor Strand, who, again, is reassessing this world and how is he going to find his way in it and get to the top.
Excellent. Alycia. Alycia with a Y. So, Alycia evolved very quickly, it seems. She was almost...
I feel like it was slowly.
Do you think so?
Yeah.
It seems, well, for the viewers, it feels like it happened pretty quickly. Maybe to you because you live with it day to day for so much of the year.
Yeah, I mean, and also, it's, you know, I feel like it's been a setup to season 4 of seeing a teenager grow into an adult as well. So for me, that journey feels very... layered and long, I guess. Sorry, what was your question? I totally hijacked that.
My question is, should Victor Strand run for the hills in a skirt? The answer is yes. So, do you think Alycia is... Do you think she's... Because she had to kind of go through this evolution where you realize, like, oh, she's kind of another mom in the family unit. Because Nick is so screwed up and Madison's always trying to deal with him, and because Alicia's so capable, she's just been kind of left on her own a lot. Do you think she began to get comfortable with that, or was she able to justify that in any way? Where do you think she's at the end of the last season?
I think she finally pushes back against it. I think she's done being the golden child, done being the responsible one, having to be stronger than she really should be. And she's endured so much, so seeing her actually walk away at the end of season 3 was a big moment for her, and I think it showcased where she was headed, which was to be her own independent person.
Right.
Yeah. And I think that's what we get to finally see in season 4 as well, is we see her become, I mean, she has become a leader in a sense, but we really get to see her find that in a it's a big development, but it's character.
Great. Danay Garcia, it's so crazy that there are 2 Walking Deads with a Danay on each show.
Yeah. I know, we talked about it.
But, Luciana, she disappeared for a little bit. We didn't know what was going on. She's a great character. She's obviously very focused, super strong, but also very vulnerable at the same time. Like, she didn't seem too hesitant to be able to open up to Nick. So can you talk a little bit about how she's grown, where she's at now, what we can expect to see from her in season 4?
Well, first of all, I love playing characters that have layers. And I really focus on not just playing the strong woman, but also bringing, you know, the layer of being also a fragile woman. And certainly the relationship with Meg, which is a bit complicated. she left because she needed to find her own path, and she was losing those values that meant so much to her. And the values were like family, you know, being part of a tribe, community, because that's where you find the strength. And in that time apart, she realizes, you know, it's really the way forward now more than ever. So we certainly reunite because of that.
Is it possible to hold a community together in this world? Because I feel like what Walking Dead teaches us is whenever you see like a gated community, you're like, well, that's going to be on fire. That's not
going to
last.
Let's roll with that.
Well, that's kind of the risk, you know? You take the risk to like, okay, who should I hang on to? It has to be worth it. It has to be the right person. Because you know something is going to happen.
Right. But ultimately, it's, you know, what I love so much about this world is that it really... It's so much plays with the idea of like what's right and wrong, and where do people kind of place their values? Is it on the community? Is it on themselves? Is it on their kids? So that it's not that people are necessarily evil, they're all just trying to survive.
Absolutely. I honestly think in this universe, there's no such a thing as being a villain. Colman and I were talking about it, when they say, oh, what do you think of the villain? I'm like, what villain? We all are trying to survive, whatever it takes. I mean, hopefully you can keep your sanity going, but you can really go to really dark places to make it happen.
Well, and in terms of like a character who's gone to dark places and come back, Morgan has definitely been on both sides of that. He was, you know, when we first saw him, he was just a dude.
then he got clear, then he became a peaceful mutant ninja turtle, then he became a killing machine again. I mean, you know, I always think Morgan has a very, it's all or nothing with him. What do you think that is about him?
He's a man of extremes. He's, if you're gonna kill, you might as well kill everybody. Seems to be his thinking. And if you're not gonna kill, then you shouldn't kill anybody.
Right. Is he getting better at blurring the lines and compromising, or is he still kind of an all or nothing guy?
I think one of the things that's been really enjoyable about being on Fear is that exactly that, the lines do get blurred. It's a time now when Morgan's existing and he's not friend of Rick, confidant of Carol, buddy of the guy who's got the tiger. He is...
That would be Ezekiel?
That would be Ezekiel. And but he's now in a place where he has no history in Fear and to the people of Fear. And so he gets a chance to decide who he's going to be now. And that's been really exciting.
I remember when I it was really sad. That's sort of like Scott said, when you were you're crossing over, you're leaving one show. It was really sad. Like, in our hearts, Morgan is over there. Then I ran into you a couple months later, and you said, I was really nervous because I didn't know what to expect. And you said, it has been an incredible experience in Austin with this cast and this crew. And you really, you seem to embrace it 110% like a character named Morgan. So, are you feeling...
I mean, I think it's one of the things that Scott says, like, you know, when you lose a character in the show, that there are real world consequences because that actor is no longer around. And I think we kind of went at it a bit like you do in the apocalypse when you come across new people and you're in new situations. You have a choice, you either band together or it separates you. And it was really cool because, you know, this is a good bunch of people. That's one of the things that's good about this universe, is that it's really cracking actors, but it's really cracking human beings as well. And we all kind of, you know, pitched in, saw what the issues were and tackled them, and moved forward in the right direction, and it's been a joy.
10 points to Gryffindor for using a British term like cracking. Because you have a foot in both shows, basically, you've seen both. How does it connect for you? Like, what's the connective tissue that you see, and how is the show its own voice but still connected to the universe?
In all honesty, I'm still figuring that out. I had very little time between the end of one show and the start of the other show. I had like 6 days. And so I don't, at the moment, I'm trying to resist all comparisons because it's like comparing, I don't know, your sister to your girlfriend that you've only just met and you think might be important to you. So, but you don't want to compare the two. Also, you don't want to be thinking about your sister and your girlfriend at all.
I just noticed that when I said it out loud.
You don't want to compare them.
When it was in my head, it made much more sense.
You know what? You know, these panels are kind of a Rorschach test.
And don't ask me questions.
Things about ourselves. You don't want to compare them. You don't want to mix them up.
But anyway, what I meant to say is,
you know what? Listen, I don't want to compare. I'm from Tennessee. You don't have to apologize.
One's my sister, and one's my girlfriend.
Yeah.
So, I also Maggie Grace, who's joined the show this year. Who is
very quickly.
You know, and I was just thinking about how I would have loved if social media had been around while Lost was on, because that was really sort of the beginning of like the hardcore, like the, you know, like fans really communicating with each other, and you feel a real community around the show. How have you felt about joining this cast? And are you feeling the Walking Dead connection yet, or do you think maybe it'll happen more once the show airs?
I mean, I'd love for the people at this table to describe the Walking Dead connection. I feel like that. Kind of song and dance number.
It's good. It's all about how your girlfriend and your sister.
Yeah. I was like, so which one are we? Are we the sister, the girlfriend, my sister?
And the apocalypse, it doesn't matter.
It's the apocalypse.
Yeah, we're
on hot stuff.
Yeah, come on, it's fine.
But how do you, you know, coming into this established universe, the show feels like it has a slightly new voice and a slightly new point of view. What did that feel like coming into this group and this world? Because once you're a part of the Walking Dead family, you're in it for life. And, you know, you'll see these fans and people, like, you're a part of a community now. So are you feeling that yet?
I definitely am. I mean, they couldn't have been more gracious and wonderful. And it's, believe me, terrifying to show up to a, you know, a show of this caliber, you know, kind of jumping on board, you know, with not that much notice. And they were just so welcoming and lovely. And luckily I was, you know, dropping into a character that I love and respect, so it's been great.
Well, let's talk about her for a second. Althea, what can you, is there anything you can tell us about her, obviously without giving anything away in front of the show?
Guys, can I? So, like, when you took a Rorschach test, I was like, holy crap. It's like, I think I win the least sleep at the table award, because I was on set at 3 a.m., like, in the background of that truck shot, so I've had, like, couple hours of sleep, so this is all like an AMA to me.
This also must be like a weird fever dream. Am I on stage? Am I on thousands of people in Anaheim?
I was in Texas, now I'm in Anaheim. It's so crazy. I'm not sure what I'm allowed to say. I love her. She's unusually capable. She has a real agenda, a transactional side, and a soulful side, and,
I mean, I would say, I think the thing that we love about Elle is she's someone who is kind of thriving in the apocalypse in a way that maybe other people wouldn't, in a way that we really haven't seen anyone kind of in the Walking Dead universe.
Well, that's what's sort of fun about this show, is that when you change the environment, who do people become? And what is their, you know, moral and ethical axis, you know, is if they're sort of like neutral good pre-apocalypse, do they become lawful or chaotic after the apocalypse? And is that who they always were, or is that what they were made in this world?
Oh, yeah, and to that end, without giving it away, part of why Althea is able to thrive so well after the apocalypse has to do with who she was before the apocalypse.
Yeah, she amazingly does not change that much. And even weirdly, her circumstances haven't changed that much. She is uniquely qualified to be in the apocalypse, and she has an agenda within there.
That's a very
sad. See how glorious they are?
If we could, for the next 10 minutes, just talk vaguely about things.
Althea's a person, she eats food, or she wears shoes, or maybe not.
Careful.
I think she's a really fun character that people are gonna just dig watching.
I dig. She's scrappy as hell.
It'll be really fun when we come back here next year and everyone's seen everything, and then you can sort of talk about it and people can ask and they understand, because right now they don't have any frame of reference, which is why you should watch the show in a couple of weeks.
But she's got the best car of anybody.
Mind resistant.
Most awesome ride.
Excellent. And, what
and she does like new people.
She does like new people.
We have a staff.
I'm like, what can I say that the trailer already shows? She likes people and
Garret Dillahunt, who's on one of my favorite shows of all time, Deadwood. Garret. And it was hard not to get a little misty watching you gunsling and go, oh, Deadwood. I would have hosted Talking Deadwood. I would have hosted it.
There's a lot of Deadwood here today. I saw Molly here just a minute ago.
Yeah, Molly Parker was on the last panel.
You saw Kim up there.
Kim was up there, yeah. So John obviously is skilled in ways. What sort of vagaries can you tell us about John? Excited about with him?
Well, I love this character, I gotta say. I too was really nervous to join this crew, because, you know, I'm a fan of the show. You know, I think some of you know I've been trying to get on this show, or one of them, for a while. And I'm finally here, and I'm grateful.
Let it out, everyone. Don't be afraid.
You know, sometimes it's hard to play a character. Sometimes you just fit right in. You just slip it on like a worn boot or something. And this one feels good. Yeah, it's better than a sister or something.
On
not sure it is.
I thought a food analogy for a cowboy is pretty straightforward. But he has other clothes as well.
Okay.
These guys are meme ready.
He is a creature of, you know, this century, but he is comfortable with his old school skills.
Yes. Excellent. Jenna Elfman, dear friend of mine. I'm so excited when I got the text and you're like, I'm gonna be on the effing, I don't know if I can swear about it, but it's funny, like you watch a zombie show and then it's like, oh, you're watching people's guts get ripped out and you're gonna be offended by the word fuck, really? No language, I can only watch people's eyes get gouged out. I draw the line after that, no
That's
language. But no more F-bombs, so I'll take the heat on that one. But Naomi, there was a photo with you and Madison covered in oil. Can you expound on that a little bit? What's happening? Who is Naomi?
That was one of my first walker kill stunt scenes. And, you know, Naomi, I'm not going to get back to that one scene, but I want to connect something to Morgan and those stories of isolation versus community, and like Morgan's whole in and out and struggle with that, carrying over into this show, and sort of like a big old punch in the face, these characters, every single one of them, are thrown face first into their own personal dilemma of character. Who are they when faced with the isolation versus community struggle, and where their sanity fits in both of those situations. And when we find my character, she's a capable survivor, but she's in that trauma. And she's in a heavy trauma. And you don't recover from trauma on your own. You need a community. But there's a lot of liability that comes with community. And so when we find her, she's on the run, and she runs, she's very skittish. And that kind of helps me find my way into that oil tank. And that was an intimidating day, because there's a big learning curve, you know, on the stunts, the walker kills, the mythology surrounding it. And I remember I went to the set early and I got the stunt guys. I was like, okay, walk me through this. Like, what are the rules? Because I'm so honored to be part of this universe. And everybody in this room, it's kind of cool. And I actually really get your passion for it, because I think the storytelling is really special. And I wanted to honor everyone, and I didn't want to do anything wrong in terms of the walker kills or anything, because I wanted everyone to celebrate it. And so anyway, I worked really hard on that.
Oh, that's great. But I love you.
Yeah, and it was really, 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 really wet.
Good walker's good.
And I'm a good walker.
But you've done so many different types of things, and I've been wanting to ask you about, you know, the sitcom schedule. Yeah, it's like 4 days a week, 10 to 4, you know, so, versus this kind of, is this the most physically demanding show you've ever worked on?
By far, like the amount of Epsom salt that I have in my bathroom, next to my bathtub. I'm doing as many of the stunts as I can, and I was a professional dancer my whole life, so I'm pretty capable physically, and I really, really enjoy stunts. Like, I think it's really fun. So I like to do as many as I can myself, and I've been doing a lot of them. And between the stunts, physical stunts, and the actual killing of the walkers, and then the emotional journey of Plank's character and her complexity, I'm very tired. No, I'm very happy at the end of the day, and I really enjoy a good Epsom salt though.
Well, let's open up the floor to questions now. If you have a question, please come forward. Now is the time. Oh, you got there. Well done you. What is your name?
Hi, my name is Chelsea.
Hey, Chelsea, what's your question?
My question is for, well, anyone who wants to answer. Since we're seeing a character from The Walking Dead cross over to Fear, if you could pick any character from Fear to cross over to The Walking Dead, who would it be?
Morgan. This would be, did you say Morgan?
points.
Chelsea, hi. It's a rad question, but it's like asking us to vote somebody off the island. We like each other a lot.
God, I don't know. Oh, man. Anyone? Can anyone think of one that could cross over? Oh, John wants to be. Yeah, Garrett's going to cross over already. Yeah, he'll jump back up for it. Do you have, did you have one? Is there someone that you, do you have a character? Can you ask Chelsea? Can Chelsea just...
Yeah, it'd be Strand or Madison.
All right, excellent.
Why?
Strand reminds me of Abraham in a way. He's kind of got that quirky sense of humor, and I feel like going into Rick's groove, it'd be nice.
You know, I need to liven things up over there, right? Okay.
But I can't imagine...
I'll take my cocktail shaker, basically. A lot of fun.
But I can't imagine... I'm trying to imagine Victor Strand saying any of the colloquialisms that Abraham said, like... I can't imagine Victor Strand going, oh, you really got on mixing that baby batter. Like, I can't... The Bisquick line coming from Strand is pretty sexy when he says it. Hello, what is your name?
Hi, I'm Lennie.
What's your question?
My question's for Lennie. On Walking Dead, you did a lot of being mentored and mentoring. Which character, Fear the Walking Dead, would you like to teach the way of the staff?
Oh, I think that Morgan has lost so many mentees. The moment Morgan walks up to him and goes, let me look after you, run for the hills. Because he loses more young people that way. So I think he's best not teaching anybody the stick or the staff at the moment. And I think, well, I know, he's trying to remain on his own, even amongst all of these guys.
Excellent. Hey! Oh, sure.
Thanks for the 10 points.
Oh, you're welcome. Oh, yeah, you're Gryffindor. I'm taking it back, because Ravenclaw, it's Ravenclaw. It is. No, you're wrong. The Gryffindors are the jocks, they always win the house club. Ravenclaws are the nerd. Wit among measure is man's greatest treasure, and the Ravenclaws are the nerds. So, take your ball and go. There goes the jocks. I'm kidding, we can all be friends and unite against the Hufflepuffs. Guys, they're kind of derpy. All right, fine. What is your name?
Hi, my name is Kylie. Last year I went to Comic-Con and I asked you guys if you had nightmares about zombies, but since there's new cast members, my question is if the new cast members have nightmares about zombies.
The new cast members?
Yes.
Garrett?
I guess I haven't. I have nightmares about this cast.
Oh!
They come undone. I love them, but...
Jenna, have you had the zombie cast?
No, but I have two young boys, two children, and they've been watching, you know, tons of Fear and Walking Dead, and then sometimes they wake up in the middle of the night and they come and they're like, Mama! Like right in my face. They're like, I had a nightmare! I'm like, okay, here I am. You know.
Stab it in the brain.
I'm gonna take it up some salt bath and then I go back to bed.
Yes. Thank you so much for your question. Hey, what's your name?
Hey, my name is Brendan.
And what is your question?
This one's for Alycia. What has been your favorite experience on the show so far?
Wow. Oh gosh.
That's very good camera work there. You found a prank.
You saw the prank.
Don't be afraid to
get in. Don't cut off my head. Good for you, sir.
I'm going to say Colman Domingo. My favorite experience.
Your favorite experience.
There have been so many different amazing points to this show. We've moved to different cities. We've had so many great cast members join us and leave, and it's hard to pick just one. I think what's great about this moment right now is kind of rediscovering this show and making it bigger and expanding it and having it collide with something. It's really special. I don't think you get to do that a lot. So it feels very unique right now, and especially moving to Austin and then having just a new place to experience this is really exciting. I think it shows too. This trailer is incredible. It's so different from anything we've seen in the show so far. So I feel like it's a culmination of all these experiences that right now feels very special.
Excellent. Thank you so much. Thank you for your question. What is your name?
My name's Christy, and my question's actually for you, Chris.
What?
If you were in this world with these people, but yes, everybody disbanded, who would you align yourself with to keep you safe?
Man, come on.
I'd just like to remind you that I have daggers and an MRAP.
But just save the writers.
This show or both shows?
I actually asked you this question a couple years ago and you picked Carol for the other group.
I did.
You did. So this specific cast.
Oh my god. I don't know.
Yeah.
Damn it. Well, I'm a pain in the ass. I don't think they would want to have me around. Like, what am I gonna do if I hang out with them? Like, in this apocalypse, I'm useless, first of all. If they wanted to sit down and talk at the end of the day on a couch, I could do that. Oh, tell me about your day. How many infecteds did you kill today?
We might need that in this world.
You might very well need it. I don't know, because everyone has like a it's kind of a superpower about them. I sort of feel like Madison's great, but she also always feels like she could just unhinge at any minute. And there's stuff about her that you don't know. Strand is great, but then if he's too much into Strand at any given moment, then he would totally sell me off for food or something. I don't know, something would happen. And Alicia's great, but at a certain point, she should be like, I need some alone time, and then I would be alone, and I don't know what I would do. Danay, I feel like, would just kick the shit out of me, so I don't know. I don't know, this is the tough one, and I don't know anything about the new characters, and then Morgan would either super hug me or super drive the staff into my brain. You just don't know on which day, so I don't know if I could really pick anyone at this point. I just think it's too, don't make me decide. I ramble when I'm nervous, I don't know what to say in front of these people.
Humor is a very, very valuable commodity, and you would run a good barter system.
I would run a good barter system for that. So would you and I align, do you think?
I'm in.
Okay, yeah. Great. All right, there it is. I'll sit. Did you have someone that you...
Probably Alycia.
Yes. You would make this work.
Right. So you pick Alycia. Excellent.
Good choice. Strong.
All right, thank you. I cannot pick any of my children. Hey, how are you?
Hey, I'm doing good.
Good. What is your name?
My name's Sabrina. This is to the writers. I've been writing for about 9 years now, so I'd really like to know, what are your favorite characters to write? Like, the most interesting, and why?
On the show, or do you mean just like anything they've
done? On Fear the Walking Dead.
The panel run, I'm sorry. That was a dumb question on my part. I apologize. Oh, like on this show? Oh man, that's good. Oh, I didn't think about that. I'm sorry, I'm dumb. You're right. Is there a particular character that you tend to gravitate toward more?
I think writing for Madison this year has been fun. I think there are things that Madison will do this year that I think will surprise people a lot. I think Kim is really, really funny. And I know that, you know, it's not a comedy, but she's had these one-liners this season that just have been hilarious while she's been doing this really emotionally stirring stuff.
It'd be funny if I was like, how's season 4 different? We added a laugh track. Various times.
Yeah. Like it's a show.
I beat you to it. I'm sorry. I apologize. Did you guys want to answer too?
Oh, no, now you're asking us to
pick our children.
Yeah, I know. Not so fun, is it?
I know. It varies from episode to episode because, I think kind of throughout the course of the season, we have episodes that are kind of shining a light on different characters, but I would say, you know, an episode we were working on a little while ago had a lot of fun Victor Strand lines that we had a very good time pitching to each other, and... Your voice
called it? Excellent. Thank you so much. What is your name and what is your question?
Hi, I'm Stephanie. I just wanted to say I love the show. I love all of you guys. I basically grew up with the Walking Dead franchise. But my question is, was there any improv that made it onto the screen? And if there wasn't, were there any scenes that you wanted them to go on?
Well, first of all, the writers wouldn't admit this, but the entire show is improvised.
It's actually much more like Curb Your Enthusiasm. About Lou Salmine.
Is there any freedom to play a riff, or does anyone throw anything in last minute and you're like, oh, that's great, or do you guys pretty much have to stick to the...
It's pretty tight. I mean, what we're doing is pretty ambitious, so our days are pretty jam-packed, so yeah. You know, most of the directors come in with a pretty solid plan, and deviating from it can mean we don't get to shoot stuff we really want to shoot.
Sure.
But, you know, we are constantly surprised in all the best ways by what this amazing cast does with the scripts that we put out. So, you know, there are surprises to us that we don't foresee that come back, and it's always great to see.
I think
that we didn't anticipate.
Some of the coolest stuff is when we write a line and then we see the dailies and see how it's played and be like, oh, like, I didn't even, in my wildest dreams, imagine it could have been read like that. But like, it adds so much more depth to it. And that's kind of the cool thing. It's just this, like, collaboration that comes out of rewriting and what everyone brings to it.
Great. Thank you for your question. Hey, what's your name?
Yeah, I'm Anthony, and I'm from San Diego. And will we learn anything about a time jump, and what can you tell us now?
What time jump?
Nice. Right to the point.
I don't know what to talk about.
We are playing with time, and there's
a time machine.
There is a time machine, yes.
I hope that makes a blog somewhere.
It only works in real time, though.
Yeah, it only goes in one direction. Yeah.
Thank you. But we are playing. We can't talk about any jumps, but we do some unusual things with time this season.
Is it? Oh, it just like slinks away. All right.
Yeah, I felt like we disappointed you.
That almost kind of reminded me of Arrested Development.
Hello, Vince Giraldi.
But if you watch the show, you'll find out in a couple of weeks. You don't have to wait that long.
Or we can cut to it now.
Let's do it.
I meant to, yeah.
In our time machine. What is your name?
Hi, my name's Rick, and I have a question for Lennie James. If it was up to you, would you allow your character to mention anything about your past to any of the characters here on Fear?
That's a really good question. The short answer is, that's a really good question. I think that part of what goes on in this world, I have to try and answer this question without giving you any information whatsoever. There is one particular character who is pretty keen on knowing Morgan's history, and Morgan is pretty keen on not letting that person know. And that plays out in this fourth season of Fear the Walking Dead.
I mean, the truth is, the truth is, if Morgan tried to explain where he came from, everyone would think he was crazy. Oh, I came from this place, and there was like a king and a guy with a tiger, and then there was this Freddie Mercury impersonator with a bat that had barbed wire around it, and then some other stuff happened. Like, it just
everything. You've been reading the script.
Yeah, I've been reading the script. There's a guy with a mullet who talks like a D&D manual. No one would believe it. Like, oh, he's on drugs. What is your name?
My name is Luke Cheeseman.
Hey, Luke.
Hey, Luke.
Hello. My question is for Maggie Grace.
You said that like, I'm Luke
like,
Cheeseman.
You know, you've got like a superhero.
So, were you expecting?
Star-Lord.
Star-Lord. There you go.
That's my role. Good question.
What is your question?
Anyways, my question for Maggie Grace is, what inspirations did you use to develop your character?
Gosh, I'm sorry, I'm so distracted by the asker of the question. He's my cousin, and I was really nervous about whatever question that was going to be.
This is your cousin?
Yeah.
This is your cousin.
We grew up in Ohio together.
Yeah. Cheeseman!
Oh, your cousin. Yeah,
you got Cheeseman.
I got Cheeseman. Yeah. I was like, oh my god, what is this question?
When you were four and you pooped in the sink, where were you? Does he follow you around and like just like pop up
to
every con?
Explain yourself, Cheeseman.
Screw with the question at the lockout panel a few years ago. I asked her what her mom thought about the movie, so I think she was expecting something like that, but thought I'd keep it simple.
At that one, I was like, man, I'm in a movie with Lennie James, but we have no scenes together. Like, what the hell?
Oh, yeah, we're in lockout. That's where I know you from.
Gosh, I forget the question. Preparing for the character, I believe?
The question was, what's an embarrassing thing you can tell everyone about Luke Cheeseman?
So many things.
I mean, he sort of put himself out there for it. I gotta be like...
I didn't think about reversing the table.
You could, yeah.
Right. And I've had no sleep, so don't mess with me. No, I think... there was a lot in our conversations going into it. Again, it's like this gorgeous dance of giving nothing away, but yeah, I think, you know, the character is really, she's...
Thanks a lot. Well, we know she's like a hardcore survivor. We feel like we can find that, so where did that come from?
I think she sees a kernel of nobility that she's really struggling to get to and to highlight, and what separates, you know, us from the walkers at this point. Like, what in humanity is, you know, not just, you know, in competition and in this hard scrabble, nasty, brutish, and short life, but what are those moments that rise above and find real grace and humanity?
That was an excellent answer. That was an excellent answer,
Luke.
Thanks a lot. Jeez.
Oh, man.
Sit down.
Nice to see you.
See you in Ohio.
Ohio.
Hey, what's your? Who are you related to? Anyone? Anyone here? Oh, hey.
Hi, Chris.
What's going on? Are you my sister? Are you my girlfriend? I don't know.
Oh. I don't think your wife would let you know those.
You're probably right. So what is your name and question?
My name is Chris.
Me too. What's your question?
For Garret, you have played a lot of gritty characters, and you played a lot of funny characters, like in Raising Hope. Which do you prefer?
I don't know if I have a preference. I like the change, you know? I like trying to do something different than the last thing I did, and this fits right into that. But I will say, I think this guy has elements of all those things, which pleases me very much. I hope it pleases you.
Excellent. We have time for one more question. Another big crossover here.
Really?
Yeah, I'm looking all right. I got a question for you, Alycia. Would you like your character to find another love interest?
I like this proposal.
Would you mind just like walking back and forth down the aisle?
Yeah, do I have a choice?
That pose was everything.
Oh, here we go.
Be careful what you say.
So, Alycia, Alycia, this is Negan. He lives across the country from you. You haven't met him yet.
Yeah, funny outfit. I guess I get what you get with the, what is the impersonator?
Freddie Mercury impersonator? Yeah. No, you gotta do the dip. You gotta do the dip. There, baby. I'm doing it again. Yeah, there we go. Love it.
Done. Done.
Let me tell you something. Jeffrey Dean Morgan asked for a raise. You don't need him anymore. You got this guy. So would Alycia, like, what do you think about Alycia having another love interest? Would she want to be in a relationship? Does she want to be on her own? How do you think she's feeling right now?
I think she wants to be on her own. But I think what was interesting in the last relationship was that it kind of wasn't really a relationship.
Right.
It wasn't. It was very realistic in the sense of these are two people that are doing the best with what they can in the circumstances, which is trying to create a little bit of hope or companionship and support. So I quite like that it was a bit vague and ambiguous. Going forward, though, I like that Alycia's coming into her own as just, you know, as herself. And it's she definitely wants to be on her own, which
too.
And I love that it wasn't, you know, yes, she was kind of seeing someone or whatever it was going, but it didn't define her. It didn't find her.
No.
And she was kind of the one who was like, hey, 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 you know, I don't know what this is, but take it
easy. Yeah, I mean, she was really wearing her hands by the end of it.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
She was the one in charge. She was like, yeah, this is done now.
She don't even know stinking man.
Nobody does, really.
Not really.
But I want to thank you so much. Your cosplay is fantastic. Thank you for doing it again. And I feel like we might be out of time. I think there's another panel coming on, so I don't want to take too much time. But I do want to say April 15th is the day. You're going to watch Walking Dead. You're going to watch Fear the Walking Dead. You're going to watch Fear the Talking Dead and Walking Dead. The cast will cross over. That starts at 9. And just stay in the whole night. We'll see you tomorrow night for Walking Dead and Talking Dead. Enjoy WonderCon, you guys. Give a huge hand for the cast.